and welcome to our program, Where God Weeps, a program where we speak about the situation of the suffering church around the world. In India, Christians number a little bit more than 2% of the total population. Despite having a long historical presence in India since the time of St. Thomas the Apostle, Christians are under increasing threat, particularly from Hindu nationalists. To tell us more about the story of Christians in India, it's my great privilege to welcome Professor Chad Bauman. Professor Bauman is a professor of religion at Butler University, as well as an expert in religion and society in India. Professor Bauman, thank you for being with us here today in our program.
It's a pleasure to be with you, Mark.
Professor Bauman, I want to come right to the issue. You are an expert on religion and society in India. You're an author of a number of publications, including a book titled Christian Identity and Dalit Religion in Hindu India, 1868 to 1947. And now you're working on a book about Hindu-Christian violence. Why? What provoked your interest in Hindu-Christian relations?
I think a number of things. Basically, when I started off doing my research in India, I was looking at the colonial period and looking at the interactions of Hindus and Christians in the colonial period. And that research looked at some of the ways in which Christians found ways to integrate certain aspects of Hindu faith and belief into their own faith and belief to make Christianity feel more at home in India. And so that's a positive story, in a way, a story of accommodation, a story of people trying to build bridges between the various faiths. But at the same time I was doing my research for that, there was a growing tide of conflict and tension and even violence between Hindus and Christians that has really increased since the late 90s. And I couldn't help but notice that. And so as soon as I was done with the research on the colonial period, in this time of relatively good interactions, at least in the part of India I was looking at, I began to look at this more contemporary period and the more contemporary issues of conflict and tension and violence.
And now you're in the process of writing this book. How close are you?
One book is complete. It's called Pentecostals, Proselytization and Anti-Christian Violence in Contemporary India. And that tries to explain why Pentecostals are one of the primary targets of anti-Christian violence. And there's some really obvious and not so obvious reasons for that. And then I'm also working on a more general book on Hindu-Christian violence that is complete. There's a manuscript there. It's looking for a home. So it hopefully will be out in a year or two.
India is regarded as one of the cradles of civilization with strong pluralistic traditions. The post-independence concept of India was a nation based on civic rather than ethnic or religious identities. How important has this been to India's progression, to its growth? For example, in comparison, or rather contrast, to Pakistan, which was founded really on a religious basis.
Yeah, I think it's been incredibly important for India that it's had this pluralistic founding from the very beginning. And it's true that there's a real contrast here in India to some of India's neighbors. Pakistan and what became a part of Pakistan, Bangladesh, are examples, I think, of how things could have gone for India. And the fact that things were different in India is the result of a number of things. Strong leadership that had a respect for diversity and pluralism in the early years, Nehru, Gandhi, etc. But it was never a foregone conclusion. There were debates even in the pre-independence period between groups that had a more monolithic, a more exclusive vision of what should make the Indian nation, and groups like Gandhi and Nehru and others, or groups led by people like Gandhi and Nehru and others who had a more expansive, inclusive vision for the nation. And I think it's important for India, or it's been fortunate for India, that more inclusive, tolerant, diverse vision of the nation won out and actually was predominant for so much of India's early history, such that now I think Indians are used to it and they respect it and they understand the value of it, so that there is a large and loud community in India that continues to fight for those values, even as there are other people articulating other less inclusive and more xenophobic visions of what the nation is and should be.
That brings us to our next point, which is precisely today, in 2014, there was a tectonic shift in Indian politics with the election of Prime Minister Modi, a self-avowed Hindu nationalist, and the BJP party. The BJP party relying on or growing out of a tradition which even predates India's independence from Britain, to a political tradition in which promoting the idea of India as essentially a Hindu tradition. So for the first time, religion as being the foundation of a political movement or political tradition. Where is this BJP coming from, and what impact are we looking at today?
So the election of Modi was a really significant point. It was a landslide victory, a massive amount of support for the BJP, the first time ever with an absolute majority. And that's really significant. The BJP party, which has embodied this notion of Hindutva or Hinduness as the essential identity of the Indian nation, that ideology has been around for a long time. It was articulated first in the 1920s, or it was articulated clearly first in the 1920s, and has always been part of the national conversation. From the pre-independence period into the independence period, this idea was always relatively strong, was always there. In the early independence era, it was drowned out by other voices and by the legacy of people like Gandhi and Nehru, some of the early important political leaders of India. But it's always been part of the debate in India. There's always been a substantial population that has supported this ideology and has supported the opposition, usually the BJP in opposition, in the elections. And so the BJP has won power in several states over the last few decades.
But it's never been dominant like
this.
Never
been dominant, right.
And how is it that Modi then rose to power? Was it based on this? First of all, was it based out of fears? Was it based out of economic interest? He was very successful in the Gujarat state in raising the economy. What was it that suddenly propelled him and the BJP power to power?
Yeah, I think there are a couple of things. And one of them is just a personal matter. He's charismatic and he's got a great story. I mean, he was a tea seller who rose up through the ranks of one of the Hindu nationalist organizations, the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, or the RSS, and became a real leader. He can relate to the common person. He speaks in vernacular languages. Many Indians love him, just love his personal story. So there's that. A second part is the ideology. There's always been a certain degree of support for the ideology of Hindutva or Hinduness, and that also grows strength or gains strength from fears about changes, about the loss of tradition in the face of globalization, about the influence of foreigners in India. So there's a kind of a xenophobia or certain concerns about the Indian nation that lead to xenophobia that's there, that supports that ideology, and that that the BJP party can draw on. But there's also another matter, and that has to do with development. And Narendra Modi is widely associated with the promise of development. He is perceived to have been relatively successful economically and in terms of bringing development in his home state of Gujarat, which he ruled for many years. And so it is difficult to tell in this landslide victory what were people really voting for. And it's my sense that they were voting as much for the economic development as for the ideology. As the BJP takes power, the ideology comes to have a certain cachet. Those who might expound it or might articulate it have some cover, have some space in which to operate. And so that's why minorities in India have become concerned at this result.
You've mentioned a few times the word fears. I think fear is something, of course, that drives a lot. We see in modern and contemporary society fear driving a lot of our political decisions.
Sure.
The Muslim population, according to official census, the Muslim population in India soared to 14% of the total population. If we compare this to Christians, Christians 2.3%, Muslims 14%, and growing rapidly. India is expected to overtake Indonesia as the largest, having the largest Muslim population in the world by the year 2050. Is this fanning fears? First of all, why the strong growth of the Muslim population? And secondly, is this one of the drivers of fears, as we've been speaking about, to the reaction we've seen also persecution of Muslims starting to take place as well in India?
Yes, the persecution of Muslims in India has historically been far worse than persecution of Christians. And it does stem from this long history of partition. India, British India, of course, was one nation that included what is today Pakistan and Bangladesh. And that was a nation that had a mixture of Hindus and Muslims. And British power tried to, or the British tried to use their power to maintain good relations between Hindus and Muslims and other groups as best as they could. But with partition came the splitting of the Hindu majority in India and the Muslim majority in Pakistan. And it was not a friendly split. In the partition in 1947, Hindus and Muslims were killing each other as they filtered themselves out into Muslim Pakistan and Hindu India. And that partition violence has a long and painful legacy in both India and Pakistan, several wars between India and Pakistan over the years, etc. So the Indian fear of Muslims, to the extent that it's there among a certain segment of the population, has this long history and goes back to that time. But it's also related to continued growth of the Muslim population.
Is this immigration, or is it the growth within the Muslim population through simple demographics?
Yeah, part of it is immigration, but there is simple demographics. There is a slightly higher population increase among the Muslim population than among the Hindu population. It's probably exaggerated by those who want to stoke fears about the Muslim community, but it's there, and they are growing relative to the Hindu population. And this is part of the fear of both Muslims and Christians, that the Hindu population perceives itself to be a declining majority, a majority with declining power. And they see some of that power going to Muslims, they see some of that power going to Christians, a fear of being swamped by greater fertility rates among Muslims. With Christians, it's generally a fear not so much about fertility rates as about growth through evangelism and through conversion to Christianity. And so the fear is the same, although the source of the fear is different with the two communities.
We're coming to the top of Christians. Christians are a minority. I mean, we're talking about a little bit more than 2% of the total population, but they're also a target. The Modi government, for example, when it came into power, the first Christmas day in that mandate, government officials were obliged to work on Christmas Day, although it's normally a holiday. And rather than being Christmas Day, it was called Good Governance Day. So it set a sign, as well as we're seeing increased attacks on Christians in a number of states, violent attacks on Christian communities. Is anti-Christian sentiment growing in India? And if so, why Christians, when they are such an evident minority within the total population? They don't seem to pose any threat to anybody. Or is that not the case?
Yeah, well, you're right that this decision to place Good Governance Day on top of Christmas was at best a kind of tone-deaf political move, and at worst a much more sinister, cynical kind of political play. I tend to think it's the latter. I don't think you can accidentally do something like this in a government as well-run as India's. So it clearly seems to have been an intentional move. And there's a long history in South Asia, India, Sri Lanka, elsewhere, of contestations not only over space, religious space, but also contestations over religious holidays and celebrations. And so the idea that this government would, as one of its first acts, basically try to sort of run over Christmas, I think is indicative of a certain segment of the of that government being willing to do things that are quite cynical and quite aggressive in terms of making a statement against India's religious minorities. So that's a significant change. There also were a number of high-profile attacks, and they were in Delhi, and they were against pretty prominent Catholic institutions. And that brought a lot of media attention, partly because it was in Delhi, partly because it was well-placed Catholic institutions. There's some questions about what happened in some of those attacks, whether they were religiously motivated attacks or mere thievery in some cases. And I think some of the facts are still yet to come out in theirs, but there's about those. But there is no question that there has been a rise in anti-Christian violence since about 1998. And there are a number of reasons for that date that we could potentially go into. But since 1988, there's been a rise of attacks against Christians. These days we see several hundred a year.
Just to clarify, what are we talking about when we're talking about anti-Christian violence?
Yeah.
How does this manifest itself?
There's a whole range of forms of violence against India's Christians, and they run from the relatively minor to the relatively severe. So on the relatively minor end, you see some legal discriminations, people using regulations of various kinds to try to prevent churches from being able to operate as easily as you might wish they would like to be able to operate. Then there's a lot of interpersonal violence as well. So this often happens and is directed at evangelists and catechists and new converts. And those kinds of people are sometimes roughed up, beaten up, attacked on the road. Sometimes as they're attacked, their possessions are stolen. Might be relatively minor possessions, like some literature they were distributing, but it might be more major possessions, like a motorcycle. Sometimes they're attacked in their homes, and their homes might be vandalized or even destroyed. Sometimes they're beaten so severely they need to go to a hospital. Sometimes, much more rarely, but sometimes they might be sexually assaulted or even killed. So there's a whole range there. And there are two main kinds of attacks. There are these sort of sporadic, isolated attacks that happen here and there throughout India. And then there are periods of extreme conflict and extreme violence, riot violence, like we saw in Kandamal, Orissa, in 2007 and 2008, where there are lots of attacks.
Whole villages were attacked.
Entire villages, yeah, and over a whole, a relatively large region and over a period of months and even years in that particular situation.
Is this also a fear that the higher castes within mm-hmm. are looking down and seeing that the lower castes are in becoming Christians starting also to have a greater sense of self-worth and understanding of their own dignity as individuals mm-hmm. within the caste system?
Yeah, it's definitely the case that one of the reasons why a lot of Dalits or low-caste Hindus have converted to Christianity is because of the social vision that's articulated by Christianity, this vision of equality and of fraternity, even if it's not ever perfectly realized within the Christian church. And in fact, there is caste within the Christian church, so it's not perfectly realized. But as a social vision, it's a powerful social vision, a vision of equality, of merit-based advance. And some of these ideas are not merely Christian, they're sort of Western, and that's part of the reason why maybe that certain Indians object to them. They feel like foreign ideas. But this social vision of equality, of merit-based advance, a promise of being accepted as a human, all of these things are appealing to downtrodden segments of the Hindu population. And many Hindus have known this for years. Gandhi himself argued that Hindus needed to do better in terms of their treatment of what he called the Harijans, but the Dalits, so that they wouldn't flee the fold. And for those who fear for Hindu unity, so those who espouse this ideology of Hindutva and Hinduness and want to promote the sort of Hindu cultural essence of India as being the only and most important essence of India, they want to preserve the unity of Hindus. And so as the Dalits convert to other faiths, to Christianity in particular, but also sometimes to Islam, there's a fear of declining power, of certain parts of the Hindu community being broken off and the numbers of Hindus declining. So absolutely, there's that social vision that Christians articulate that is appealing to those within the Hindu community who are not treated well because of their low caste. That vision is a threat to not just upper caste Hindus, but to the Hindu community entirely in terms of its political power. And for those who are really concerned about preserving Hindu political power, it becomes a real serious threat.
A real issue. Yeah. I mean, it's a bit of a side issue, but yeah. Is it of consideration that if Christianity continues to grow, it will at some point provoke a revolution of sorts, mm-hmm. and at some point where the Dalits, who make up the greater proportion mm-hmm. of the population, suddenly say, wait a minute, what's going on? We've been, perhaps, have we been oppressed by a system mm-hmm. for generations? Mm-hmm. Is that a concern also within the thinking of the Hindu, perhaps the higher caste, mm-hmm. who would look at their situation and wonder, how stable is it?
It's absolutely a fear of some Hindus that the continuing conversion to Christianity could provoke something like a revolution, or if not a revolution, then a schism within the nation. So this is a concern that's been around since the 1950s, if not earlier. And coming out of that history of the partition of India and Pakistan, there is a fear of further partitions. And many Hindus will point to the Northeast, where there's a majority of Christians in certain states, and where there have been breakaway movements, insurgencies, revolutions, armed revolutions, and say, well, that's the future. If Indian Christians come to become a majority in certain states, maybe they'll try to break away from our nation. So maybe there wouldn't be a full-scale national revolution. I don't think that's really a fear of many Hindus, at least not a realistic fear. But I think there is a fear that as Christianity grows, or as Islam grows, but as Christianity grows, and as Christians come to be a majority in certain parts of the country, those parts of the country might want to break off and form their own independent nation, like Pakistan did, and like has sort of happened in the northeast of India. And so, yeah, that's absolutely a fear, and in some ways it's potentially a legitimate fear. That said, most Indian Christians have no idea of wanting to do that. That's not in their, it's not on their agenda. They feel themselves to be very true and dedicated, loyal Indian citizens. At least in my perspective, I'm not sure there's a real threat of India splitting along religious lines. One issue is that India's religious minorities are dotted throughout the country, and because of the partition of India and Pakistan, there's no real place where Muslims are concentrated in a certain part of the country, or Christians are segregated in a particular part of the country, except in the Northeast. And so, you know, it would be difficult to divide India along religious lines if you're talking about territorial division. If you're talking about continued conflict and violence between India's various religious communities, I think that's a real fear, and that's a potential future. You know, that these tensions could continue to grow, majority-minority relations could continue to sour, and we could see more violence, more conflict. There's another possible future. There seems to have been somewhat of a backlash to the growing hostility against India's minorities that's come about as a result of Modi's election. And even Modi himself seems to have tried to undermine it in minor ways, maybe not as powerfully or directly as outside observers might like. And so there's a possibility here that the BJP government goes strongly with its development platform and tries to move itself away from its sort of anti-majority anti-minority tendencies. That's a possible future. But it's difficult to know, I think, which way India will go.
What is the future role of Christians in India and the importance mm-hmm. of Christianity in India? Mm-hmm.
Christians in India have always been a really powerful voice for democracy, for secularism. And so I think it's certainly important that Christians continue to embrace that role in India and voice their support for those basic tenets of religious freedom, secularism, pluralism, diversity. So Christians have always been a really powerful voice in India for democracy, for religious freedom, for the basic values of equality and liberty that you see in any good functioning democracy. And of course, India is the world's largest democracy. So that's important, regionally especially important. So that's an important role that Christians play that I think they need to continue to play. They've also been, since the upsurge in violence against Christians, and particularly after the violence in Kandamal in 2007 and 8, Christians in India have been better and more intentional about reaching out to other religious communities and to expanding their advocacy beyond their own interests. So instead of advocating just for their own religious rights or their own political rights, they've begun advocating for other religious minorities, the Muslims in particular. They've begun advocating more broadly for Dalit or low caste Indian rights, whether that's low caste Hindu, low caste Muslim, whatever. That's an important move, I think, as well. They've advocated for land rights and for the rights of agricultural workers. So they've stood shoulder to shoulder with non-Christians in these fights in important ways. And they've also just reached out to other minorities in an attempt to expand their own networks of support. And that's also important. So I think in India's Christians can play an important role in bringing together at least the religious minorities in India. And if the religious minorities in India are somewhat unified and respect each other and look out for each other's interests, I think that will provide an important bulwark against the encroachment of anti-minority sentiment. And so that's another important role that that Christians in India can play.
And are called to play.
And are called to play, yes.
Professor Bauman, thanks a lot for having been with us today in our program.
It's my pleasure.
And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for having been with us today in our program, Where God Weeps. And if you'd like to know more about the situation of Christians in India, I would encourage you to look at the contact information at the end of this program. And we look forward to seeing you next week. Take care.